You are not where you're going. You're just on your way there. You know, don't back up. Don't turn around. Don't go back. Stand there. When you try to press toward the mark, you're going to discover that there are going to be a host of enemies already set up against you. Where did they come from? Come from? They've been there. Quit trying to make it look as if you brought the enemies there. They were there when you decided to start living for Jesus. You are playing in a game, not just because it's a game. You're playing to win this thing. And God says that you will win because God knows that He has spoken over your life, and what He has spoken into your life will come to pass. I said, what God has spoken into your life will come to pass.
The Inspiring Body of Christ Church is an anointed ministry where we use the Word of God to win souls for the kingdom of God. We are overcomers from all walks of life who come out to give God the glory. We come out praising. We come out worshiping. We come out dancing. We come out singing. Man, we come out swinging. Let's give God the praise in 3, 2, 1.
Thank you. the Lord to just bless you. If you want God to bless you, take that same hand that you have and touch someone else and say, I speak a blessing into your life first. I speak a blessing into your life first. So now we're going to have to shout for our blessings, because your blessings are at the end of your speech. You shall have whatsoever you say. Here we go. Say, bless me.
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 If I started out this morning and I said, I am the sower, and if I said, this is the seed, then who are you? You're the soil. I'll say that again. I am the sower. This is the seed. And you say, there you go. I'll say my part. I am the sower. It is my job, it's my responsibility right now to make sure that something is poured into your life. This is what I've been given to pour into your life. This is the seed. And
I am the
tell somebody and tell them who you are.
I am the soil.
And so the soil's job is to get ready and be right to receive the seed. Don't ever tell anybody, if you go to church here, I mean, that you went to church and didn't get fed. Tell them I kept my mouth shut. You didn't get fed because you shut your heart off. You didn't get fed because you were distracted by something else. The meal is right. The seed is prepared and the cook is ready to throw it down. And the meal is not about the cook, it's about the meal. Amen. Show somebody right now next to you the seed. Look at them. You ought to have it in your hand. Amen. And if you don't, show them the hand that's empty where the seed ought to be, or where it's going to be next time you come. Now tell them what this is. Tell them, this is the word of God. This is my word. Oh, yeah. And do exactly as it says, according to the book of Joshua, chapter, I will prosper. I will prosper in every area of my life. I can do it. Thank you, Father. Can you just, while you're still standing there, soil, get the soil right? you're sitting right next to, or standing right next to, your soil brother and your soil sister. Say, what's up, soil brother? Say, what's up, soil sister? That person's a different color from you, that's all right. That's your soil brother. Now, if we'll just say together, Lord, thank you for today. I need to hear from you today. I'm bringing everything in here today. And I'm leaving it with you. I'm dedicating my whole soul to you today. I need strength. I need power. And therefore, I'm asking you, Lord, to fill me with your Holy Spirit so that I can receive without distraction, without argument or conflict, without doubt, I can receive your word today. In Jesus' name, I thank you for the sower. I thank you for the seed. Now make the soil right. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a seat. Amen. This will probably be the first message that you have heard in a while here that did not rightfully apply to you. What did he say? I said this will probably be the first word that you have heard here today that does not apply to you. Well, then why am I here? Now, remember, my job today, I am the what? So what if the Lord is saying to you today, now I need you to be the sower. It's time for you to do some sowing. If I can do the delivering, what if God is saying to you today, I want you to do the delivering next? Well, Lord, what am I going to say? Well, okay, he said, I'm getting ready to tell you what to say. So now you're going to be the sower. You're going to take the seed to someone else. But their hearts will have to be ready to receive it. So sometimes there's a word, every great once in a while, there's a word that God will give you. And I'm saying this because I am confident in here today in knowing that those of us that are believers, those of us that have been followers of the Lord, there are some things that we have learned how to get past. Some things we're learning to do. Other things we've learned because God has delivered us and we are just grateful for it. So let's get on with it. Turn to Proverbs 12:25 in the seed. The seed today is going to be Proverbs 12:25. Now, I say this because whenever the seed is thrown down, there's a harvest from it. God's word never comes back empty-handed. It is always going to do what God has assigned it to do, and God has assigned his word to do something today, and it is going to happen, and it won't take me long, but I have got to do a lot of seeding today. I've got to do a lot of pouring in seed. A lot of pouring in seed, because a word like today will immediately tell others he has no idea of what I'm going through. And I'm going to tell you, you are absolutely wrong. Proverbs 12:25 in the Message Bible. I'm reading from the Message Bible. My Bible is on big screens, all three of the screens right now. It said, worry does what? Worry weighs us down. A cheerful word does what? Picks us up. Most people that you see walking around today, if God was going to give us a one-word message that he wants you to deliver to other people that are wanting to trust him, this is the message on worrying. Now, amen. You can sit down. Don't worry about it. Okay. Now, remember I started the message by saying this is a message today that really won't apply to you because you understand already what it means to worry. And if you don't, then you're going to get a lesson on it. When you came in here today and someone invited you, or a member, you came out of your house knowing, when I get to church today, God is going to teach me a word, and I'm going to be specific and ready for him to teach me. Now, there's so much we can and could worry about. We can worry about our bills. But we don't do that anymore. You can worry about our careers. You can worry about our relationships. You worry about our children. People worry about their exams in school. Kids do. Grown people do. I think the older you get in school, the more you worry about exams. We worry about our health. We worry about our age. Ushers, you may take your post now, please be seated. We worry about our health. We worry about things that we really have no control over. Because most of the things that we worry about are just temporary things anyway. You got all worked up about your hair falling out and it fell out because it was on schedule. You weren't doing anything wrong. That's just how time is. You worried about gaining weight and it just came. But it was just what? Temporary. Because time just keeps up with us, y'all. Time knows more than we could ever imagine. And so worry is one of those things that comes along and it kind of puts a dent in our lives. So the list could go on and on and on. If I ask everyone in this room right now to tell me some things that you have worried about, that are worrying about, or that you could worry about, it could go on and on and on. And it's amazing what things will bother us if we let them. Okay? And remember what I just said. This message is the only message that you've heard probably for a while that may not apply to you. So that means now you got to get some notes together because God's going to send someone to you who's broken down. And instead of, girl, you need to, no, you're the you need to. You're going to get to feed someone. Remember what church is now. It's a place where God comes to equip us. He told us to go out and spread the gospel, not just me. There's a word that we know about. There's a word called anxiety. Everybody say anxiety. And it's a normal part of your life, okay? There's always something that's going to bother you, something that's kind of churning around on the inside. Most people don't look like they're going through anxiety. Most people don't look like they're, quote, stressed out. And this is not the message on stressed out. I have a whole different message probably on stressed out. I'm just talking about being worried today and anxiety. And maybe you're calm, real calm person until the pressure builds. And once the pressure builds, you become overly apprehensive. You get a little aggressive. Most people know you as a very calm person, but when stress hits, when anxiety hits, you turn into the Incredible Hulk. You tell people, you don't want to make me mad. Your pressure goes up. Your fatigue level goes up. You pass out. Pass out pretty. Makeup was on. Now, you didn't look like you were going to pass out. You pass out handsome. You're very healthy, but you're on the ground. Because anxiety overtook you. Now, if this does apply to you, it's okay. God just wants to talk to you today. He's not going to fuss at you. When anxiety hits, when worry hits, and these are things that we tend to not want to talk about as Christians because, see, all of us know that the Lord will make a way somehow. And so when we talk about it and we look at it, Sister Johnson, and we start to focus on it, we realize now that God is doing something. And he's working it out for us. But it just doesn't seem like he's doing enough or fast enough. So our anxiety starts to build up. And then your sleep is disrupted. And your mind starts to whirl until circumstances change. And sometimes it just doesn't seem like it's going to change. It's just, I'm going in a circle one day after another. And once life is back to normal, then you're okay. But when that stress builds up, when that worry comes, when that anxiety starts to go, you lose focus for a minute. People can't even tell who you are anymore. Then you have to go back and usually do a lot of apologizing. Because when you lost it, girl, you lost it. When you lost it, man, you lost it. You brought out some things in your character that you'll never be able to take back because you'll say, I'm sorry. People say they'll forgive you, but they'll always know you can go there. They never knew you were a chunker. And that's a word that we use here. I don't know if that's an official word, but I just brought that up. Maybe you usually continue trying to go through life the same way, but you still have a lot of different ups and downs. And every once in a while, though, there'll be something that's hanging around at the back of your mind. You're sitting in here listening to me right now, and when I said this message didn't apply to you, you took a deep sigh and went, "Woo, maybe he's going to talk about something crazy." And all of a sudden, it's making a lot of sense to you because you never realized until today that there are some things that are kind of lingering in your mind. You say they're not there, and you tell someone they're not there, but every time you have a moment to yourself, you're building up your own pressure. Either way, the question we need to ask ourselves is whether worry ever helps us. I thought for a long time that most things that happened to everybody else was my business. And I have finally grown to realize that everybody's problems are not for me to solve. And I'll just say something else since only half of y'all clapped. Your problem is not my crisis. I used to take everybody's problem as my crisis, and I had to fix it because I thought, Sister Taylor, that it came to me for me to fix it. And I didn't realize until not so long ago, that the only reason God allowed some people to come to me was to bring what they had to him. It was just that simple. And so, counseling became real easy. Listen and give it to God. But that doesn't solve enough for a lot of people because sometimes people want you to give the answer to problems that they created. Pastor, can you tell me why I steal so much? As I have everything in my office in my arms. No, I can't really tell you that. I don't really know. But we're going to pray right now with my eyes wide open. Some people have a natural tendency to worry. A natural tendency for worry. We call it a propensity. They don't even know they're worrying. They don't get that they're worrying. They're just worrying. Right now, you're worried about when we're getting out. You're worrying if I'm going to have enough time to finish. You may be worrying about coming back this evening and know you're not coming back this evening. You may be worrying about who's going to show up. Can I come to Monday school tomorrow? No, he just mentioned next week. And you're just overloaded and you can't even unload. We just ask God to fill us with the Spirit. And right now you're wondering and worrying and is this the right dress? Or is my dress fitting right? Or is my suit fitting right? And it's not just concern. You get overly concerned. And in reality, nothing is really... It's not really that bad. My grandson, I had this little video of him. I'm not going to play it this morning. I almost started to. But it's a video of his mom. She went up to him one day and she told him, "You keep acting up, man." He's about one. He's just learning to talk. She said, "You keep acting up and I'm going to take your eyes away from you." And so he just kept being silly or doing something. And she just reached over and she took his eyes. She said, "I got your eyes." He lost his mind. And he cried for like 3 minutes or a minute and a half. "I want my eyes back. I want my eyes back. I want my eyes." He was losing it. Grandmother's getting upset. "Chris, don't play with him like that. Don't tease him like, I want my eyes back. I want my eyes back." And he's just losing his mind. I'm thinking it's kind of funny, but you know, I'm kind of strange like that. "I want my eyes back. I want my eyes back." And she started talking to him. "Do you sure you want your eyes back?" "Yes." "Can you see me right now?" "Yes." Then start thinking about it. What do you want me to do? "Get my eyes back." He could stop. And so he got quiet. He realized, you know, it's not so bad not having my eyes. Then he figured, well, I got to keep this act going. So he started crying. Because he had a natural tendency to just worry about some things like that. And so she just went, "Okay, here." And he went, Some of us, we tend to worry about things that are already taken care of. Now, I want to tell you this morning, I want to tell you from the depths of my heart, and I wish I could just sit in every one of your seats and hold your hands and tell you, you know, and this is not some old jive. I don't jive. I don't give jive pulpit talk. I'm not here to hype you. I'm really here to tell you something that I've learned, and I just wish I had learned it 30 years ago. That most things that we worry about are already taken care of. You've just got to live to the taken care of part. See, worry works against us because it kills us before the taken care of happens. And I don't know how you say that word, but it really is taken care of. Things that you stressed out about a long time ago, if you think about it right now, those people and those things have passed. Matthew 6 chapter. We're going to do something I don't really do. I want the word to just speak the rest of this to you for a minute. Matthew 6 chapter 27 verse in the Message Bible. I'm going to put it right here in front of all of us because I want us to all get this together. And I could go through and I'm going to talk about this, but I want you to hear what the Bible says because I'm the sower. And what must I sow this morning? IBOC, what must I sow this morning? See, as a church, we've got to start understanding what happens when a person stands in this position. When you stand in front of people, you have to sow the seed. So I do it all the time. I do it every week. But at some point, I need to make sure that you see the seed and you prepare yourself as the soil to receive it. So it says, has anyone by fussing in front of a mirror gotten taller by so much as an inch? Now, this is right in your Bible, sitting in your lap. But the translation is here to make you understand it. All this time and money wasted on fashion, do you think it makes that much difference? Instead of looking at the fashions, walk out into the fields and look at the wildflowers. They never primp or shop. But have you ever seen color and design quite like it? They do nothing to get themselves together, but you're always admiring them. The 10 best dressed men and women in the country look shabby alongside a wildflower. If God gives such attention to the appearance of wildflowers, most of which are never even seen, if God puts that much attention into them, don't you think he'll attend to you? Don't you think he'll take pride in you? Don't you think he'll do his best for you? And if I'd written the Bible right here, I would have put, why are you tripping? But what I'm trying to do here is to get you to relax. To not be so preoccupied with getting. So you can respond to God's giving. If you just say thank you, you'll realize that the next thing that you're even about to pray for is already. But boy, if you're all into getting, you're not responding to God's giving. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things. So your mouths are proving you don't really know him. It's proven that you've heard about him, but you don't know. You don't know him. The key is you know both God and how he works. Repeat after me. I know God and I know how he works. No. Now you've got to see it. You get a bad doctor's report. You got to say, I know God and I know how he works. Somebody walks out of your life, slams the door in your face. I still know God. And I know how he works. I wake up in the morning, I got a sore on my face. I got aches and pains in my body. My child walks away from me. My family life ends. I'm in court. They're gonna lock me up, but I still, and I know. That's not a hype talk, y'all. If you know God and you know how it works, then worrying sort of eliminates itself from your life. You still have to work. Steep your life in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. Don't worry about, I didn't get to have any kids. I didn't get to get married. I didn't get to get a promotion. I didn't get to get a job. I didn't get to get my hair done. Stop worrying about missing out. You're going to find all your everyday human concerns will be met. Give your entire attention to what God is doing. Y'all don't know this word. Right now. You're thinking about tomorrow, and you're messing up everybody else's today. I'm teaching. I'm not supposed to be preaching that loud. You just ruined the whole family reunion worrying about next year's reunion. And don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. Now I need you to find somebody to sit next to you and tell them if that blessed you or not. Amen. Last part of this verse says, God will help you deal with it's whatever. This is a, now listen, see, it would be different if Pastor Rush was trying to hype you, but this is seed going into your soil. The seed is telling you now, God is going to help you deal with whatever. It's got to be hard enough for God to deal with it though now. Whatever hard things come up when the time comes. There is an assigned time for your answer. Boy had his eyes the whole time. But he heard information that made him think he was going to lose his eyes. You can spend a whole night panicking over your problems, rehearsing every possible outcome, but your problem is going to be there when you get up in the morning. I promise you it will. In fact, your problem will probably be bigger than it was before you went to bed. You know why it'll be bigger tomorrow? Because you're exhausted now. You're tired and trying to deal with the same thing. Anxiety is not just unhelpful, y'all, it's harmful. You can die from a heart attack with strong muscles trying to impress people with how strong you are, but you're not strong enough to even lift your thoughts. She looked all right to me. What do y'all think happened to her? Well, it looked like she just stressed out. Dealing with those children, dealing with all that stuff. But she was such a strong woman of faith. Well, cares, other folks' issues, because we're so loving. Y'all got one of those church sheets we use. Let me see. And you know those things y'all cover people. Oh, let me get one of these. Okay, come here for a minute, Brother Josiah. I'm just going to do this. I don't know. Okay, this one, cricket proof. That's our church mascot. Don't ever step on the church mascot. Okay, what was I saying? Okay. This is faith. This is worry. Breathe normal, in and out. Okay, just keep, okay. He's giving signs of breathing. Okay, now, I'm not going to do this because I could go to jail and we'd be on TV. But this is like a mask, okay? I'm going to put it over him. I'm going to tighten it up. What just happened? He acting too good. No, so do it again. What happened? I just suffocated him. Why? Because I covered up his breathing. I blocked his breathing off. Worry suffocates your faith. Okay? And what most of us are going through right now is you're getting weak because your faith is getting weaker. And why is your faith getting weaker? Because worrying is suffocating your faith. Faith tells you that everything's going to be all right. Worry says, not this, and not now, and not you. And then when you start to really worry, you stop seeking God, and you start looking for Doug. You know Doug. Everybody got a Doug. Somebody else to be God. Somebody else to take that place. God tells you you're going to get yours on time. But God's not moving fast enough, so you go and get it from somewhere else. Now you're in debt. And now you no longer have a bill, but you're worried about if you're going to die. Because people that are going to leave your life are going to leave anyway. But before they left, they suffocated your faith. See, because whatever someone takes from you, with God, you're going to get it back anyway. Unless before they leave, they choke out your... Is this making sense? Okay. See, I never thought that worry was that serious. But I've realized when you go back and look at your record of your life, everything that almost made you lose it, before you almost lost it, you worried about it. And when you started worrying about it, you couldn't have the faith to talk to God, because it takes faith to talk to God. But if you can't breathe, you can't talk. And without breathing, it's impossible to live. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. We talked about it last week in the Bible. We talked about it right here. We just didn't realize we were talking about it. We're talking about the seed and the sower. See, that's why the Lord told me to explain my role to you. Because too many people are trying to evaluate me and you don't know my role. I don't need to be the best preacher in Dallas, the best preacher in America. I need to be the sower of this seed in this field. That is the best I can do. But boy, if you don't watch it, worry will have you trying to compete with people that are not even in your league. And so you die being a successful nothing. You've accomplished everything except what God called you to do. And so the Bible says that if you're not careful, you can be suffocated. It's right there in the Word. It was in there last week. You can be suffocated with worry. Right? And it'll kill you, and you will not be able to bring any fruit to maturity. Nothing you do gets finished, because every time you get in the middle of something, you trip out. That's second service. You freak out. Now, that was the old third service. You panic. When I was in college, I changed majors every semester. I finally went under undecided, and I finally went into whatever's fastest. Just get me out of here. Why? Because everybody's thing looked good to me. Some of you have a tremendous envy problem because you don't trust God for your design. And because you're getting older, you're thinking, God, I don't know what I'm going to do yet. I don't know what I'm going to do yet. God said, have you noticed that you're still living? Maybe you're going to major in life. Maybe you'll be one of those people who will be able to write a book about my soul looks back in wonder how I got over it. But if you keep trying to find yourself in somebody else's career, somebody else's enjoyment, you're going to suffocate your own faith, and nothing you do, there will be no fruit that will be able to be mature inside of you, and that fruit will not ripen. It just won't. You worry, your mind spins, your heart pounds, your stomach knots. The next time you go to the doctor and they just can't find out what's wrong, ask him to do an x-ray on your worries. That's why most doctors, when they sit down and talk to you, they ask you questions that sound like they're trying to be psychiatrists or trying to talk to you like shrinks or like you're schizophrenic, but they'll just say things like, what's on your mind? Is there anything bothering you? And right there at the time, well, no, not really. Because you don't know that it's bothering you because it's been so subtle. Because some things you can't control, you just have to trust God with it. Maybe you've become a little irritable. Look at the person next to you and say, that's right. Look at that person back and say, stop talking to me. See, you're so irritable. Hey, let me tell you something. I don't know how many of you take notes, but I know I took to a church of people that take notes. But when you start getting irritable, let me tell you something that nobody will tell you the truth about. You don't pray to God. I don't care what you're saying. When you start getting very irritable, you do not pray to God. You panic to God. And you treat God like the best friend you ever had that you never appreciated. Be careful about being irritable. You'll get right down to the altar and tell people, I'm praying to God. No, you're not. You're panicking to God. And it might be that you don't have a full-fledged care in your life right now, but you just have maybe a little bothersome, nagging thought. You know, what we have a word for it here at IBLC. It's called a what? If y'all from another church, please don't read this. This is a personal family note. We just call it a little old bitty thing. It's not big, just a little old bitty thing. Like, my inspection sticker didn't pass. Well, it's not due to November. This is September, but I know me. I'll just go to bed. You worry about little old bitty things. Those people, dog next door hadn't had water in 2 days. You nosy. The dog did like you, drink all the water every day you looked out. Just little, you just bothersome about little bitty thoughts. You just nosy. She served in the church 2 months. I had to serve 3 months. That's such a little old bitty thing. You saw her serve too. You didn't see the labor outside of what you saw. You just nosy. All these people dying in the world. Oh, Obama, what are you going to do when he leave the White House? It's going to rain next week. You messed up. Just the bitty things. He making fun of me right now. People laughing. The whole church laughing at me. I can tell. He's preaching. He won't look over here. He's preaching. He just keep looking over here. Just a little old. Touch my shoulder. Shook her hand. But you know what happens? That little worry starts to dominate you. It starts to dominate your thoughts, dominate your conversations. And before you know it, every time you get on the phone with somebody, you're talking about worrisome things. Doesn't matter how much you worry, they'll start to affect you eventually. And worrisome thoughts will start to choke the word of God out of you. Because somebody's going to keep saying, well, you know what God's word? Yeah, I already know. And I know what the Bible says. And before you know it, this right here today doesn't mean anything to you. It's a form. It's just something to do on Sunday morning. But when you really start to feed and need God's word, people say, you go to church this early. There's a lot of people that come to church every Sunday morning at 7:30. I still thank God for this. There's never a Sunday. The Lord woke me up about 3:45 this morning, and I said to God, is it you? You won't wake me. Is it me? You know, sometimes you think God wake up the wrong people. Lord, I'm okay. I'm good. You ever talk to God like when you just give him, like, Lord, give me just 15 more minutes. And there's nothing worse than trying to talk God out of a nap. There is nothing worse than that, man. I'm bending over, and God said, I want you to write down two words. And I don't have anything to write with, so I turn on my phone. God said, write down walls and fences. And I'm writing down walls and fences. He said, walls and fences. And I'm thinking, Lord, what is this? Walls and fences. The message today, Lord, that you've given me is on worrying / second service tripping. Don't tell them. He said, but I want to talk to you about these walls and fences. So I got up. Got ready for church, came on to church, looking all the way to church for some walls and fences. Past McDonald's, walls and fences. 4:00 in the morning, driving them down Cocker Hill. Lord, where are the walls and fences? Because I know when God starts to speak, he's trying to get a message to someone. And so what the Lord is showing me is that some people put up walls because you can't let anything block your faith. You just gotta turn your back on anything that's gonna block your faith. But sometimes you'll have that wall up, but you call it a fence, and those fences always have gaps in it. And so when you look through those gaps, sometimes you just always see little things to worry about. And sometimes God is telling you, build a wall. And Satan is saying, oh, that's okay, break the code, build a fence. So that every once in a while he can show you things you should be worried about. Because once you start to worry about them, they're gonna do what? Choke your what? It'll suffocate it. Is that blessing anybody? When your child goes off to school, you got to start trusting God. I almost blocked the whole thought of my child going to school because I just didn't think I could trust her for being in Atlanta that long. Period. I just didn't. And I finally got past it. I never trusted her. I never did. Not one day. But I always trusted God. Y'all get that? Mom didn't trust her. I don't guess. But we trusted God. You got to keep trusting God. I could not afford that. But I neither could afford her not getting that lesson. She stayed there one semester. There. Can I come home? Nope. Why? I'm not through trusting God yet. He's making a way out of no way. Holla at ya. She called me one day about 2:30 in the morning, 3:00. Something scared her up there real bad. You know, she got in touch with real life. And on the cool, I was scared. I'm sorry, that's a second service thing. In reality, I was fearful. I'm sorry, I went on the cool. I was scared. I shouldn't have said that. I was a little fearful. Because I knew that there was nothing that I could get to. I couldn't fix it. But that's the thing that was killing me before with stress. I had to fix everything. Some of you are going to be surprised when your real friends find out that God never called you to be a fixer. He just called you to be a healer. And the only way to heal things and involve God's people is to feed them God's word and then trust God for them. Is this okay? Is this blessing you already? Okay. It's amazing for a sermon that you didn't need, right? So you have to understand that when we're worrying, we're not believing God. And that's the thing that made me stop worrying. I realized I wasn't believing God. And under these conditions, the problem now has become bigger in your mind than the problem solver. So now I have this problem I need solved, but I'm really worried about it, which means I'm not believing God. So the problem is bigger than the problem solver. And that's never the answer. And the Lord is real clear, church. He's real clear about how we're supposed to respond to anxiety. And of course, it's got to come right from who? From him. Where is that? From the seed. Because as the sower, I'm sowing the seed into you, the soil. And he's real clear about how we're supposed to handle it. He said, be careful for nothing. But in everything, bam and bam, by prayer and supplication, he said, with giving thanks. And the best way for you to ever start your prayer off is to say thank you for something first. Okay? I mean, if you really want to let God know that you're talking to him, God loves praise. So before you start any of your prayer, you should always say, Lord, I want to thank you today for giving me the opportunity to pray. I mean, the baby's sitting here sick, and you don't know what to do. So don't start, Lord, bless my baby. See, remember, you're not praying to God. You're panicking to God then. So when you pray to God, you got to come to God in his way. That's his way. I didn't make that up. That's seed. So you know, so some people, well, I preach and say, well, okay, I don't care what your preacher said. My father said. When you go to him with prayer and supplication. And he said, but with thanksgiving, whatever your requests are, if you want God to do something, thank him for something else first. Lord, I can't get my car. Okay. Lord, I want to thank you for my bus pass. Hallelujah. Now what do you want? I want my car. Hey, you get it. Do we have, okay, so right now, everybody in the room, let's practice. You know where you are, IBOC, and the C stands for practice. We can laugh at that all the time. People laugh all the time. I never seen people go to church and y'all still been at practicing. You still be preaching, you know, and you been practicing like they're in school. Well, we'd rather deliver people who are going to heaven and know how to get there than to have a whole bunch of hollering folk that are ignorant as hell. And you know what I'm saying. That was second service. I'm sorry. I don't know why it's second service time. So let's practice. Let's practice asking God for something. Now we're just going to do it so nobody next to you will get nosy, because you know nosy people start worrying. And nosy people can hear when you quiet. I mean, seriously, real nosy people, they can read your arm. Oh, watch out now. She get ready to do something. So I'm going to give us all the same speech. Let's all pray for a great Monday school tomorrow. Let's pray for a great Monday school tomorrow. So our request is going to be, Lord, we pray that your spirit moves in Monday school. Let's practice it. Lord, we pray that your spirit moves in Monday school. Lord, we pray that your spirit. Okay, so that's the what? That's the what? That's the request. So how do we start that prayer? Let's say, Lord, thank you for a great Sunday service. Ready, go. Thank you. Now put your request in. And we pray for a successful. Yeah. Don't start by saying, Lord, let my baby graduate. You didn't get it out. You just said, Lord, let my baby graduate. So I understand the panic of graduation, but maybe the first thing you ought to do is say, Lord, I thank you for the ninth grade twice. Won't he do it? And some people here did the ninth grade twice. See, they understand it. Hey, oh, wait a minute. So anyway, God, let your request be known to God. And of course, the God of peace, you know, well, let me finish this. Pass all understanding. Give peace with Pat all understanding. That God shall keep your hearts. And worries all uptight. How's he going to do it? Through Christ Jesus. If you go to him with thanks, then with the request, God's promise is, I'm going to fix your heart and your mind. And don't worry about your problems. If you don't have that car, you didn't need that one. I have something up the road if you trust me. Now, if you don't trust me, you're going to go and overpay yourself on this one because you talked to too many people about that. You didn't talk to me first. You talked to me last. You go to God and pray after you decide you want that car. No, thank God for the hoopty. No, seriously. Why that girl sitting over smoking on I-30? Don't go to God in panic. Go to him in prayer. Lay hands on the Lord. I want to thank you for hoopty. She don't know it, but this is the last time she gonna break down on me. Thank you, Lord. She got me through trials and tribulations, but I'm gonna leave her here for the tow truck. I'm gonna dial AAAAAA. Come get her right now. Now, Lord, I want to thank you for my BMW. Then you move. You go. Thank you for hoopty first, y'all. That's not Pastor Rush. That's God's word. Hey. God can always tell somebody the difference between someone who knows him and for people who just say they serve him. There are some people who say they know me. I can tell by listening to people 5 minutes, and you can too if they know him. Yeah, I know y'all, Pastor. He was a drum major out at Pinkston. You don't say anything. You just, And y'all so nice. I've heard some of y'all. Yeah, he's yes, he is. You just All right, let's get through with this message. The Bible is telling us here in these scriptures that there's nothing that we face in life that really warrants our worry. Now, I have to tell you, in teaching this and being a Christian, as long as I've been a Christian, I just think there's some things I need to be a little worried about. But there's nothing. The currency of heaven, the value of heaven, the riches of heaven, the ching-ching of heaven, ching, is that how you spell ching? Huh? What's another way to say this word? The cho-chos. I don't know how to spell cho-cho. Okay, the cho-cho. I don't know how I never heard of that. What's another? The bread of heaven. Hey! The dinero of heaven. Which the N-A-R-I-O, dinero. That's Spanish. I don't know that part. What's another? The guap. I don't know. But the currency of heaven, you know what, this is all second service stuff. I need to, can I get some first service? The finances of heaven. Thank you. I'm sorry. Oh. I'm sorry. I just know that most young people are worried about things because they think they're running out of time and they haven't even stepped into their time zone yet. But the finances of heaven, the currency of heaven is found in your faith. If you have strong faith, you got dough in heaven. You got bread in heaven. Let me tell you why your faith is so important. You got saved by faith. If you don't have faith, you're not even saved. You don't even believe it. You've got nothing to prove you're saved but God's word. Is that blessing you yet? You cannot pull out anything that says you're saved. You got saved by faith. That's rich. You receive every provision you have by faith. We must pray in faith. And the way for you to access God is by believing his word. Because without faith, it is impossible to please him. The just shall live by faith. God speaks to us through his word. That strengthens our faith. All I'm doing today is giving you his word. And all of a sudden, you're sitting here right now going, shoes, I won't worry about that then. And I'll feel it coming, and I'll say, oh, block it. And I don't know what struggles you're facing right now, but I do know that there's nothing too difficult for God. Now, I can promise you that. And one of these days, maybe before you leave this earth, you'll have a child that'll help somebody verify that for you. Children don't think that there's anything you can't do. They don't think there's anything that you can't do. Somehow, some way or another, you'll do something, and they will think, how did you do that? How did you come up with that? How did that happen? I got a little piece of a broken arm on an eyeglass. You know, kids have shades, right? They have shades. And the arm is broken. And so my grandson the other day, he picked up the glasses and the arm was broken. And so being a Mr. Fix-It, I asked him, you want me to fix it? He said, no, I'm going to take this to my grandma because she can fix stuff. You see where it is? It's in my car, because that boy doesn't know what he's talking about. No, but it's amazing to you that they go to people that they think can fix stuff. And one of these days, God's going to know that you're smiling because you know he can fix it. And sometimes I'm thinking I can fix it. I'm thinking somebody else can fix it. God said, no, I got it. I got somebody lined up that can fix that. Now, it startled me because I never heard him say something like that before. But he had got a shot that day, so maybe he wasn't feeling good. I'm just teasing. Somewhere he has learned that there's someone that can fix things. One day you're going to learn God can fix it. And then when you do, you're going to start talking loud like that. Don't worry, I'm not worried. God's going to fix this. Oh, I wish somebody would. Now, I had two options when I heard him say that. I could get jealous, envious, and stupid, or I can think somebody else has proven that they can fix it. Are y'all listening to me? It is amazing that God can be speaking to your spirit in one area in church and you can get so sidetracked because you think that God cannot use something to fix you. Satan can use worry to break us. Here's another thing. Let's go. Almost got to go. 1 Peter 5, 7 and 8. King James Version of the Bible says real quick. Another word for care right now are things you love, things that worry you, anxieties, things you're concerned about. What is the Lord saying to do with all those things? Put them where? Wow. Because things you love are heavy. Things that bother you are heavy. Things that concern you are heavy, and those things will break you down. So God says, here's what I want you to do with them. I want you to cast them on me. Another word for cast is throw. Are y'all listening to me? Is it making sense to you yet? If you care about it, if you love it, if it's bothering you, God says, give it to me. Why? Because I care for you. See, the thing you love may not love you. No. The people you're caring about may not, but I guarantee you, I love you. So if they're the ones who're going to break you, I want you to give them to me. If you care about somebody hurting you, God said, give them to me. You mean my enemies? Yeah. Give your enemies to me. Give your money to me. You care about your money? You care about your money? You care about it's offering today. Some of you will right now intentionally give God some excuses instead of a gift. You told him, Lord, if you bless me, I'll bless you back. But you haven't even been blessing him, just kind of been chucking something at him. But he says, if you care about your job, I told you the one scripture in the Bible that made me completely change my mind forever till I die. Because I kind of, you know, wavering between tithing and giving. I would give sometimes, and sometimes, you know, Lord, understand, the Lord know my heart and all that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. When I read in the seed that when I give, that the Lord will protect the fruit of my ground. And when I give, that means God's going to protect my child. When I give, I'm making sure Satan doesn't destroy my grandson. Child, I give before I get paid. I find something to give just to say, God, I'm holding you to your word. Why? Because I care for him. And God said, whatever you care about, give it to me. If you don't care about it, don't give it to me. You need to shake somebody next to you. Just shake them, shake them, shake them, shake the care out of them. That's when you start talking about that right there, being sober, vigilant, because the devil, as a roaring lion, he's walking around seeking whom he... Password! Ding, 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 ding. Major word in the whole sentence. He's seeking whom he what? May devour. But he's not going to devour you if you've already cast what he... Oh, I got to do some. We run out of time. 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 Josiah. Josiah. Okay, all you ladies right here on the front row, come. We're going to play catch. We're going to play attack the ball. Okay? Now, y'all got to attack. Back up, Josiah, because we got to attack whoever has the ball. Ready? Go. Ha ha. Ha ha. Okay, freeze. Where did they go? They went wherever the blessings were. The Bible says if you care about something, give it to God. Get it away from you. Because the devil is seeking whom he may devour. Who's he going to devour? That person that's keeping that tithe, keeping that offering. If you keep it, Satan's going to attack you. He's after that blessing. But if you pass it on, you give him to God. Did that bless anybody? I'm sitting there holding on to my offering, holding on to my issues, wondering all the time. I'm always broken down. The Bible says he's seeking whom he may. He's just looking. He's not even a lion, y'all. He just making noises. He comes as a. It didn't say that he was. Ain't everything about that joker's fake. But he knows if you don't know God's word, he can make noise and make you run. You'll stop running one day and go, that's not a lion. That's a mouse with a microphone. So if he may devour you, that also means he may what? May not. And that means he will not if you cast all your cares. Okay. Practice time, practice time, practice time. Whatever you care about right here. Put it in that hand right there. Put it in your hand. Now, I don't care how heavy it is. You're jealous, you're mad, you're uncomfortable, back's hurting, sides hurting, body's aching. Those are cares. Your new car, your new home, your hair, your surgery. You know, things that just kind of, you know what I mean, your future, your career. Put it there. Now, those things are as important to God as they are to you. But the reason those things are overweighing you is because you're trying to carry it. You know how many, put all your kinfolk in there. No. All them $5 and $10, give me some gas people. Put them all in there. Put the gas people in there. Don't look at them. Don't look at them, girl. Amen. Don't. You can't look at them in church right now. Amen. Put them in there. Now, See, what does God want you to do with it? I just want you to throw it straight up. Don't throw it toward me, in Jesus' name. Y'all got a bad habit. Here, Pastor, I don't want the thing. Just throw it away. Ready? See, what do you do? That's just symbolic of getting it off of you. Oh, I didn't tell you to clap your hands. See how free that was when you got rid of that load? You just automatically, oh, Lord. Some of you can't praise God. You know why? You got so many cares in your arms, cares in your heart. Other folks' problems are becoming your load. If we really understood that the Lord loved us, every aspect of our lives, then our perspective of God would change. Not only does he care about every issue we face, he also has the power to make a difference. But all he asks you to do is follow his instructions. The most difficult thing about school is not teaching, it's hoping that kids will follow your instructions. The Lord does not ask us to ignore our anxieties. He doesn't ask us. He commands it. He commands you. Get it off of you. It's not good. He says, just like you would allow a fly to land on your meat, don't allow worries and anxieties to land on you. I'm going to say this. It's not going to make much sense. Say that's nasty. Now, that's not a good word to use, but I want you to just, worry is nasty. Anxiety is nasty. And God's not, he's not asking you to do that. That's a command. Who sits up in church all day worried, all the time? You came in uptight, sit uptight, and hope you found an uptight audience to view you. They're not paying any attention to me. You know why? Because you're dressed like a worry. And I apologize if that hurt anybody's feelings. But the reason most folk aren't paying you any attention anymore is because you always come to church dressed like an issue. You got dressed in the dark and forgot to put the light on. And so you say, well, I'll go somewhere else. You're still going to walk in there as an issue. You're just not recognized by the people who don't know that every time you come, you dress like a worry. And putting a smile on your face does not make the issue go away. You're just a happy issue. You're a smiling anxiety. The Lord commands us. Don't worry. Let it go. When I was learning how to live without worry, because I want you to know I didn't pick this up. I had to learn it. Okay? You got 5 minutes for me to teach you how I did it? Monday I taught you guys how I would gain strength and encouraging myself. And I pulled up a chair. And I talked in front of the whole church about how I was able to encourage myself. And at the risk of looking stone crazy, I turned my chair like this and said, this is how I would talk to myself. I would talk to me as if I was encouraging someone else. And all of us like to think that we're some kind of old bootleg counselors. Girl, I have to talk to you about something. You got time? Oh, sure, baby. I'm not listening. You know, that's nosy. What? So I did. I put myself just like that. What, Ricky? What? So I would encourage myself the way I would encourage someone else. But that's the same way I learned how to get rid of my cares. I would think of everything when I first started learning how to live, like, because it has become a lifestyle. And for some people, they might deem you as someone who's not interested. But you have to be so interested that you don't become a major issue, you know, by their worries overloading you. So everything I would do, every one of my issues, whatever thing was I wanted to give, I would do it one at a time, like those bills that come through the mail. That's not me. Occupant. They're going to have to just come get that. You know how you gonna do that? So that's the way I did my issues. That's the way I did my worries. And that's what I do every day. things that I really want God to have, I take it, I specifically say it. God, this starting church at 7:30 is really heavy because I don't want people to feel like we don't care about them. It's getting out on time. Lord, that's a problem for me because I know I want you to be free to explain the word. I don't want to be just systematically. And people say, well, they would come if they knew they could get out on time. And I know a lot of churches, Lord, that they can get out on time. But I don't know what on time is now because I don't know how much time anybody else has to live. So, Lord, just help me to teach at your pace. And I want to be clear. And I give it to him. It's just like that. Lord, I'm really concerned that this bow tie gonna choke me Sunday. I don't like wearing bow ties. So much going on. I got a little distracted here. And I was coming up to the school to work with the school across the street there. And I was ready to go to funeral. And I left my jacket. I had to do a funeral. I have a pants and a jacket. So I'm at the funeral. And I get out of the car and I'm ready to go into the funeral. And I realize, I don't have my jacket. So here I am at the center stage at this funeral. I have on pants. I have on just a shirt, no tie, because, you know, that's kind of acceptable when I kind of wear collars all the time, but no jacket. And I didn't want these people to see my suspenders. You know what I'm saying. Man's got pride. Y'all know what I'm talking about, don't you? And I don't know these people like that. And it's a short sleeve shirt, and I just don't go short sleeves. So now I got to make a major decision. I got to decide not to go to this funeral and fake a seizure. I don't know what plan B is. And Brother Clifton gets out of the car. He's the mortician. Have you ever been glad to see a mortician? And I just ask him, I don't know what made me, hey man, because he works at a funeral home and they dress bodies, you know what I mean. I just, you got an extra coat in there? I don't. He's sitting right over there. I'm telling the truth. I said, you got an extra coat in there? And so he reaches in somewhere and gets me a coat. Now, y'all, I am right now having stress because my coat got like Mr. Smith on it or something. I don't know. No. So I put the coat on. The coat is way too big. You don't get it. I'm the preacher. So I put this coat on. It's way down here. And he starts to adjust it like I'm just sitting there like this. Now, y'all don't get it. He's making all these adjustments like I don't know what's going on. Now, I got to walk in the funeral just like this. And that whole message, I spoke about power. And I just kept asking people to understand the power of God. And they never knew that it was not fitting. They knew it didn't match anything. Give him one at a time, y'all. Okay? Don't try to pile it all up and say, Lord, bless all this stuff. But when you're going to start living over, just a little bit at a time. Lord, this police is pulling me over right now. He's coming up to my car. Lord, I thank you for letting me drive this long. You knew your license was suspended when you saw the lights coming on. What are you trying to pray away a suspension? You know. This is it. Lord, I pray for... I just want the cuffs to not be tight today, Lord, in Jesus' name. Just give me comfort. Just give me comfort. Just give me comfort as I sit back. Just give me comfort, Jesus. Thank you for all the years you made it comfortable for me, Lord. One issue at a time. Lord, don't let me lose my temper. Don't watch my mouth. Help me watch my facial gestures. Don't let me show it. Is anybody blessed so far? All right. And I just pray this morning that when you go to Jesus with your issues, because that's who you're going to have to go to, he said, go to Pastor Rush. Look at the Bible, Matthew 11:28. Go to Pastor Rush. Is that what your Bible says, Matthew 11:28? Amplified Bible. He says, come to who? He says, come to me. That's Jesus talking, y'all. Me, that's in red in your Bible. If Jesus talks, that's in red. Whenever you see the red in your Bible, that's Jesus talking. He said, come to me. Who? Every one of you rascals who are weary, and this means overloaded. You just get overloaded sometimes. What did Jesus say for you to do? Come to him. Isn't that something? Pastor Rush didn't help me with that. I wasn't Jesus. And I'm going to tell you something. And if the Lord sends you to me, let me give you an answer. He will supply me to what to supply you with. Because God knows that you need help. And help from people who won't keep digging up that they helped you. But he's going to come. He said, go to, he said, but here's the key thing. He wants you to come to him because we can bypass Jesus. And that's how you get in debt, and that's how you got these payday loans. And you want all these new laws made because you broke God's law. All you're burdened by religious rituals and provide no peace. He said, and I will, here's this promise, give you, I'll give you some refreshing in your soul. He restored my soul. But not until I come to him his way. See, your stress, your worry, your anxiety, all of that, ladies and gentlemen, that's just called normal. The Lord doesn't want you to live with it. And if you've gone from one care to another, God wants you to say now, today, Ricky, teach them. Just teach them what you know. I can't teach you anything. You'll watch on some TV program and all. I don't know about all those things. I don't know that they work. There are a lot of people who have a lot of solutions on a lot of TV shows, even feature religious leaders. But those people have not had a born-again experience with God. The just lives by faith. You can have a good tweet or a good five-step program from people who don't need faith. So we sit up and we read a lot of stuff. We have favorite shows that we watch, and we mock all these kinds of careers by people who don't get it the way you got yours. You got yours through faith. You weren't smart. You weren't brilliant. You had wisdom. You made smart people look stupid. You made brilliant people ask you questions. How? You got yours by what? Faith. So I'm just telling you, the way that God has used me is just by saying, Lord, I'll make it a lifestyle. I'll make it a habit. And eventually, it'll become second nature to you. Okay? Don't stop accommodating these over concerns that we have. Give your cares to him today. And then tomorrow will be okay. Because if he took them today, he'll take them when? Tomorrow. Lord, just taking my cares the rest of my life. You know, that's like saying, feed me till I won't no more today for the rest of my life. I'm going to eat everything I can right now. And we feel that way sometimes, don't we? But we still have to eat tomorrow. Ooh, I've had enough. I don't think I could eat one more grape. I'm about to bust. And here comes some pecan, butter pecan. Well, if I bust, I won't bust all the way open. Yeah, you just make room, don't you? Make room. I can't tell you how many times I've committed that sin right there, boy. I know for a fact that I cannot do, I'm just learning, I guess. What's that word I am? I should have asked my doctor last week. I'm lactose not tolerant. I love vanilla shakes, but vanilla shakes don't love Pastor Rush. So I switched from vanilla shake to strawberry shake. I thought that was it, just change flavors. I went from strawberry to chocolate. I just mixed it all up. Strawberry, Neapolitan. Y'all don't know about Neapolitan, boy. No, that's 1970 ice cream. That's vanilla, strawberry, and chocolate. I mixed it all up, and none of it loved the preacher. I have tried to pray over it. I have prayed over my shake till it became just liquefied. Didn't work. So I realized it doesn't do me any good. But every once in a while, not even doing me any good, I start planning my schedule, and I don't have anything to do Tuesday and Wednesday. Lord, it's Monday night. I got nothing to do Tuesday and Wednesday. I just got to have this. Let's give God a hand. I thank God for this word today. sometimes God says, I want to just give you a very simple word because you didn't realize how much you've allowed simple worries to just destroy our relationship. Now I want you to bow your heads right now and I want you to pray with me. And I want you to pray sincere with me. I want you to pray as if you expect God to hear it. Because as much as some of us have laughed in here, there are other people in here who have had a very difficult time with this. There are some ladies who, you know you ought to be back here this evening, but you don't like women. That's a heavy load to carry. And you're trying to ask God to help you. And God is saying, the very power you have, you're denying. A sister, stop thinking about the women that you don't like and think about the women that need the gift that I put inside of you. But that becomes a worry for some people, y'all. We think it's normal. But those kind of cares, those kind of issues can bother us. So let's just be sincere with God right now. And all of you, you know, when you pray after we leave here, I want you to do like me or like I've done. Don't do like me, but do like I've done. If you care to, just go and just start naming those things one by one. Just sit on the chair, even maybe do an offering. When we do an offering after this prayer, you can just sit right here in church and do it in front of all of us. It's okay. Repeat after me and say, Lord, you know who I am. Thank you for talking to me today. Thank you for making it easy to digest. I have been worried. Today, I come to you with my burdens. And I come to you with my anxieties. I'm coming to you with all of my troubles. And I'm going to tell you one by one, the next time we talk, I'm going to tell you the things that I need to cast from me. I bring you every worry. I give you every fear. I cast all my cares on you because you care about me. And by faith, I lay down every concern and I leave them all with you. Once and for all. If they come back tomorrow, I'm going to leave them with you again. Once and for all. I thank you that every answer to every problem is in you. I will no longer try to fix these things myself. You are my loving Heavenly Father. Lord, I trust you. I know that you're more than able to see me through every situation. I place my life in your hands. I leave my burden with you. Now, in exchange for my burdens, I receive your refreshment in my soul. I enjoy the rest that comes from having faith in you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your peace. I thank you for speaking to me today in a fun, loving, caring, fatherly way. This message was for me, and I personally thank you. In Jesus' name, we'll talk later. Amen. There you go. There you go. There you go. Now we're going to give an offering.